got a video to show, and then you'll continue with our worship. Thank you.
Good morning. Today is the start of our stewardship campaign. We're going to show a short video, which was the inspiration for our theme this year. And hopefully everyone on the side can see it. If you can't, all you have to do is go on the internet and type in God's Pie, and you can watch it on the internet. And hopefully the sound will be good, too. So here goes.
He brought the pie.
We're going to be showing videos of us making and distributing our church pie, and then on the fourth Sunday we're going to be dedicating our estimate of giving. So thank you.
Printed in your bulletin is are the words for God's Pie, and Irene and Ingrid and I are going to sing it one time through, and then you'll try to join us the second time.
God's heart is deeper than the ocean. More than Good morning. There are many places we could choose to be this morning.
We choose to be here, learning how to live in God's kingdom.
I'm sorry, please stand if you're able. You are welcome in this place, filled with music, filled with prayer, filled with hope.
Sometimes God's wisdom is hard to understand, but together we study and learn.
Welcome to God's house. There is no place like it.
Together we talk about God. Together we talk to God. Together we listen to the sounds of God's love and discipleship.
Welcome to God's house. Welcome to worship.
Remain standing and we'll sing together hymn number 372, Our God Reigns. Then he'll be interred over at Strongsville Cemetery and come back here to share a meal together.
So if any of that, if you knew David or Carol or the kids, Kyle and Stephen, you are certainly welcome and invited to participate as you feel called. So, do we have any visitors? Do we have any visitors today? We got a couple of front rows here. Owen has a big family. Just go down the line. Let's see. Luke here, let's just do real quick. Go ahead, take it along and ask everybody their first name. Start here.
Lee Johnson.
Go to the next one.
Raymond Johnson.
Sharon Garstock.
Ray Garstock.
Next row.
Ray Garstock.
Sarah Garstock.
Romeo Gabrielson.
Make it work. Luke worked hard this morning.
Mike Cap.
Heather Cap.
Next row.
Tanya Palmer.
Grant Palmer.
Kelly Johnson.
Corey Johnson.
And this is Owen's family, and we're so glad to have you this morning. Do we have any other first-time visitors? Well, if you know anybody you want to bring, they will be welcome here. We will find a place for them to sit, absolutely. What joys and concerns do we bring this morning?
I have a concern. You may have noticed Doug Thorne isn't here today, and we're very concerned about him. He has not been feeling well all week, and I want to thank Sharon Heinrich, who helped me set up the bell tables. We've really missed Doug, so a prayer for Doug Thorne. Oh, and a prayer for Rita Budd. She is not back in action yet, and we just want to send our love and prayers to Rita Budd.
Thank you. Others?
I have two. One for a co-worker of mine. Her mother is in very bad failing health. But the one nearest and dearest is my daughter, Serena, who had to undergo a emergency MRI for lymph node in her chest wall. And she meets with the doctor Monday to see what the alternatives are.
Thank you. Others? Sharon.
Carl, I asked for prayers for a dear friend of ours, Gary, who's having heart surgery on Friday.
Thank you. Thank you. Judy, right here. Come forward. Warmer.
I have a joy to share. Thanks to you for your prayers, and Mindy is going back to work tomorrow.
Well, there you go. There you go.
There's for a girl that I grew up with who was just diagnosed with stage 4 colon cancer, and it's moved to her liver. So she needs a lot of prayers.
Thank you. Sam? Sue.
I have a concern. My two sons travel extensively every day, and so pray for their safety and their safe return home every day.
Thank you.
I just want to let everyone know a little bit of update. I am dealing with an infection that has not been treated in 3 weeks, and I'm still waiting for treatment on that. But I also wanted to let you know, I told you all that I was seeing an hernia specialist, and we saw him last Monday, I think it was, and they said that I do definitely have a peritoneal hernia, and I'm going to have to have a complex surgery because I've had so many surgeries in my abdomen, over 5 of them, and they're going to have to pull down the stoma and then cover up the abdomen wall with mesh. They're talking about, I can't remember the name of it, but they said it's like a plastic type, or they may do it with pigskin, depending on which they feel is more sturdy for me. And they're going to also have to not only do the stoma where the polystomal is, but they're going to cover the incisions, because I've had like 5 incisions in the same spot, so I'm weak in that area. And they want to wrap it around my other stoma that I have in my ileal conduit to try to avoid any chances of that becoming a hernia. So I will be in the hospital about a week, and they said that my recovery will be about 6 weeks, and it'll take about 3 months before recovery. So just, as far as it being scheduled, I'm trying to wait till January as long as nothing major, because Alan and I have planned a trip to go to Pasadena, California at the end of the year to see the Rose Bowl parade. So that's a positive. And yeah, I'm complaining maybe, but I do want to say I am happy and positive the fact that I am alive and kicking. So that's more important in my life.
And we are glad you are here, and we will keep you in our prayers. I would ask prayers for Chuck. You might notice he's missing. He's in Montana. His grandson turns 1 on Tuesday, so he flew out there for that. So that's a joy, but traveling mercies, get him back there safely. And also traveling for my daughter, she and her family. Poor things, they're on their way to Universal Studios. So, any other prayers, requests, or concerns?
The first row, as he starts his new round of chemo treatment tomorrow.
Thank you. Thank you. Let's pray. God, we give you thanks for this place, for this caring family, where we know that we can share with one another and have your sympathetic ear as well. Lord, we have shared joys and we have shared some concerns, especially surrounding that awful thing, cancer. And so we simply pray your comfort and your peace for those who are struggling with cancer, and for the families who support them. We lift them up before you and ask that you fill them with your comfort and your healing, that your holy presence might remind all of us that you are greater than anything, period, including the cancers that wreak havoc in our lives. Lord, we are grateful to come together, and we are grateful that you shared your Son with us, putting on flesh to help us get to understand you better. And it is in his name that together we pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I have decided to follow.
Thank you.
and please come carefully forward. There's a lot of stuff in here this morning. And if you could come on up to the top step up here, because of all this stuff. Here, Gabby, come slide over here. My goodness. Oh, my goodness. People I don't recognize and everything. Here, come slide over here, Mackenzie. And, oh, here comes Oliver, Jack, da-da-da, Big Brother Cole, and Penny, and Autumn, and Lacey, and Ella. Oh, my gosh, we have a full house. Wow. Let's slide over just a little bit. And Cole, you're going to stand up in a minute when your mom and dad come up. I know, your mom is here too. How cool is that? Ah, yeah, she's a great baby, isn't she? Hey, so what do you see up here this morning that's not usually here? Christopher, what is that?
Baptism.
Yeah, it's called the font, the baptismal font. So what's that mean we're going to do? What? Yeah, we're going to baptize a baby. Do you see anything else up here that's not usually here? Christian, what do you see? The pitcher with the water in it. What else, Luke? Use your words. What is it? Yeah, there's a card. And what's behind the card, Christopher? There's a book. What do you see? A big cross up there. That's important in a church, isn't it? There's something small and red, Christian. Yeah, and right in the middle is a single red rose. And so because we're having a baptism this morning, you know, when you really love somebody, it's kind of cool to give them flowers. And so as we welcome Owen this morning, that rose is to celebrate that he's being baptized. So if you come, oh, I don't know, in a couple of weeks, and you see a single rose up there, you'll know that there's going to be a baby baptized and that we're going to give him a flower to show how much we love him and how much God loves him. So, how about the rest of the Johnson family coming up, and we'll bring Cole up too, and the godparents. So you know Cole, right? And his mom, Brittany, and Owen, and dad, Chad. And who are you?
Ray.
This is Ray and Sarah. And they are the ones charged with the awesome responsibility of being Owen's godparents. The Gospels tell us stories of people bringing their littlest children to Jesus and how he welcomed them. Bringing him into his lap, listening to them and loving them just as they were. But Jesus' disciples rebuked the parents, telling them Jesus didn't have time to spend with little children. When Jesus saw this, he was indignant, and he reminded them all, "Let the children come to me. Do not hinder them, for the kingdom of God belongs to such as these. Truly I say to you, anyone who does not receive the kingdom of God with the openness and innocence of a little child shall not enter it." And Jesus took the children into his arms and blessed them, laying his hands upon them. The sacrament of baptism is an outward and visible sign of the grace of God. The promise of the gospel is not only to us, it is also to our children. Baptism with water and the Holy Spirit is the mark of their acceptance into the care of Christ's church, the sign and seal of their participation in God's forgiveness, and the beginning of their growth into full Christian faith and discipleship. So, Brittany and Chad, do you desire to have your child baptized into the faith and family of Jesus Christ? Will you encourage him to renounce the powers of evil and to receive the freedom of new life in Christ? Will you teach him so that he may be led to profess Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior? Do you promise by the grace of God to be Christ's disciples, to follow in the way of our Savior, to resist oppression and evil, to show love and justice, and to witness to the work and word of Jesus Christ as best as you are able? Do you promise, according to the grace given you, to grow with Owen and Cole in the Christian faith, to help him to be a faithful member of the Church of Jesus Christ by celebrating Christ's presence, by furthering Christ's mission in the world, and by offering the nurture of the Christian Church so that he may affirm his baptism? Congregation, Jesus Christ calls us to make disciples of all nations and to offer them the gift of grace in baptism. Do you who witness and celebrate this sacrament promise your love, support, and care to the one about to be baptized as he lives and grows in Christ?
We promise our love, support, and care.
All right, Cole. Are you ready to help me pour the water into the bowl? How heavy are you?
Oh my goodness.
Okay. Now, put your hand on the pitcher with me, and we'll pour it in together. Cool, huh? Thank you for your help. Christ be with you. Let us pray. Gracious God, bless this water by your Holy Spirit. By that same Spirit, save those who confess the name of Jesus Christ, that sin may have no power over them. Create new life in the one baptized this morning that he may rise in Christ. All glory and honor be to you, eternal God, who was, who is, and shall always be, world without end. Amen. Are you ready, Owen? All right. If you want to come stand around behind me over here, pull your feet in for me. Are you ready? Owen Raymond Johnson, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and pray God's rich, abundant blessing upon you. Amen. It's cold, isn't it? It was warm when I put it in the bowl. Let us pray together. Gracious God, you have filled the world with joy, with the gift of Jesus. Bless this child, Owen Raymond. Fill him with your strength and courage for life's journey. Joy for all to see. Freedom of love. Hope for a new life. May he never be ashamed to confess his personal faith in you. Bless us, O God, that we too may be faithful to your word, united in the peace of Christ and the company of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's stand together and sing hymn number 465. And kids, you can go.
Bye.
welcome Owen to the church family together. And you may be seated. You are the apple of God's eye. Without each one of you, God has no pie. Whether you are flaky, or spicy, or sweet, without you, God's pie is not complete. So as we come forward for our offerings, let us remember the one who gives us all things and be glad. In which we live. We give back to you that which was already yours, and we ask you to bless both the giver and the gifts, that we might, as we contemplate the pie we will continue to make, how we might best incorporate your desires and our needs and our desires into one amazing creation, honoring you and working to bring your kingdom and your reign into the world. Bless us, O Lord, we pray, as we begin thinking about our stewardship and our part in the pie for 2019. Amen.
Our reading this morning comes from the Book of Mark, chapter 10, verses 35 through 45. James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came forward to him and said of him, "Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask of you." And he said to them, "What is it you want me to do for you?" And they said to him, "Grant us to sit, one at your right hand and one at your left, in your glory." But Jesus said to them, "You do not know what you are asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I drink, or be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with?" They replied, "We are able." Then Jesus said to them, "The cup that I drink, you will drink. And with the baptism with which I am baptized, you will be baptized. But to sit at my right hand or at my left is not mine to grant, but it is for those for whom it has been prepared." When the ten heard this, they began to be angry with James and John. So Jesus called them and said to them, "You know that among the Gentiles, those whom they recognize as their rulers lord it over them, and the great ones are tyrants over them. But it is not so among you. But whoever wishes to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wishes to be first among you must be slave of all. For the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many."
May the words of my mouth and the meditations you place on each of our hearts be acceptable and pleasing to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. You know, as we read through scripture, we discover one thing fairly quickly. God is hardly a one-dimensional God. In the beginning, in Genesis 1, God is clearly creator of all that is. And as Moses leads the Israelites through the wilderness in Exodus 13, God becomes a pillar of smoke by day and a pillar of fire by night. God might be a burning bush, as in Exodus 3, or a talking donkey in Numbers 22. God is all-powerful, and God is a whisper to Elijah in 1 Kings 19. God is a sheltering mother hen in Luke, gathering her chicks under her wing and keeping them safe from harm. God is described as the beginning and the end, the first and the last, the Alpha and the Omega. There is one way, however, that God is never described in Scripture, but a way that James and John seem to view God in today's passage. Somewhere along the way, they seem to have gotten the idea that God was some sort of a vending machine. They act as though God is simply standing by with a pad and a pen, poised next to our table like a gum-chewing waitress, just waiting for us to ask, and God will bring us whatever we ask for. Pop a couple of quarters in the snack machine, and boom, out comes the snack. Where on earth, in listening to Jesus, did these two get that idea? Unfortunately, this image of God as vending machine is still going strong today. In seminary circles, this is referred to as the prosperity gospel. Have you heard of it? There are television preachers with thick, dark hair and beautiful wives and brilliant smiles telling us that if there's something we really desire in life, we should pray for it. And if we, you know, send a contribution to their ministry, well, they will pray with us. And if we just have enough faith, God is going to answer our prayer for whatever we desire. Pray big, they say, and give big as well. That is how God answers prayers. Well, I hope you understand that there are some fundamental flaws in this way of thinking. Flaws that can be deadly to our faith if we begin to believe that the problem is that our mustard seed faith is insufficient or will never be good enough. Friends, it is not my intent to belittle my brother Joel Osteen and his ministry, but we need to listen with a critical and discerning ear. He gets some things right and has the means to make sure they are heard far and wide. Recently he said this, "Be careful what you say. You can say something hurtful in 10 seconds and 10 years later the wounds are still there." Absolutely true. And advice that many people should remember before they tweet or talk. But on the prosperity gospel, in my opinion, Brother Joel gets it completely wrong. The gospel preached by Jesus is a gospel based on love and grace, not on works. God's gifts are poured out for us all. God's grace is freely available to every person, not just those who can afford to give deeply from their giant pocketbooks. From an awareness of the fact that God's grace is available to me and cannot be taken away by any person, place, or circumstance, then comes a desire not only to share the good news of God's grace with others, but also to walk alongside those whose lives are filled with challenges and use what we have to help alleviate their pain and draw them deeper into the kingdom of God. Grace first and works that follow, not the other way around. And given how long James and John and the rest have been listening to Jesus teach, they should have begun to understand this by now, wouldn't you think? All this time, day in and day out, Jesus has been teaching them a little every day about God's kingdom and the way to live in the world. He has provided healing for the sick, comfort for the broken, companionship for the lonely, and food for the hungry. And he has expected nothing in return. Whatever the first century equivalent of a $1 million jet might have been, Jesus never, ever expected his followers to take up a collection to buy him one. The Apostle Paul, when he asked God to take away his pain that's come to be called the thorn in his flesh, experienced a perfect life-altering answer from God. "My grace is sufficient for you. My grace is sufficient for you. Knowing that you are God's beloved children is enough." Living lives that reflect our understanding that we are God's beloved is the only thing that will change the world. And yet, James and John want to be sure that the world knows just how beloved they are. They want to be able to boast that when the heavenly table is set, their seats will be second only to Jesus in the power and status that they wield. Let's take a brief wander back in time and think for a moment about the Roman cultural influence on Jerusalem in Jesus' lifetime. If a powerful governor or leader invited folks over for dinner, it wouldn't be like a modern-day wedding reception with neatly printed place cards telling you where you were to sit and who you were to sit with. There was a different structure at work then. The tables were long and low, and if the party were large, several tables might be placed to form a large U shape. Cushions would be arranged around the outside of the U. Remember, they didn't sit at the table like we do today. They reclined at the table so they could relax and allow their food to digest more easily. So if you arrived early, you might be directed to a seat closer to the host. Late arrivals would likely find themselves closer to the doors, unless the host specifically left instructions that you were to be seated next to him. That is what James and John were asking for, that Jesus would reserve them a spot next to him, no matter when they arrived. A bit presumptuous, wouldn't you say? Especially considering even just within their close group, that meant 10 other friends of Jesus were being left out. No wonder the 10 got so angry at James and John. It's truly a wonder that Jesus never, ever is recorded as having lost his temper with these men. Jesus has explained to them three times how the Son of Man must die, and that he will travel up the road to Jerusalem, where he will be ridiculed, beaten, and crucified on a cross. James and John have been there, presumably listening, but it just hasn't gotten through to them. Three times now, he has explained to them all that when he gets to Jerusalem, his victory is not going to look like victory the way the world does it. The table won't be set the way an earthly table is set, and seats will only be assigned by the host, Almighty God. Jesus' victory involves being less, not being more. So in short, the journey to winning won't be an easy one, and the victory awaiting him is the very same victory that awaits each one of his followers. Still, James and John respond by demanding that Jesus reserve for them two of the best seats in the house, one on Jesus' right and one on Jesus' left. How does Jesus not lose his temper with these men? Now, James and John, you might remember, were the same two disciples who, along with Peter, were present with Jesus atop the high mountain when Jesus was transfigured, his dazzling divinity briefly revealed as they were joined by Elijah and Moses. Remember, the heavens opened wide and God was clearly heard speaking by James, John, and Peter. This is my beloved, my son, with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him. They were terrified, falling on their faces before God, as any reasonable human being would, right? And I suppose Peter had the best response, wanting to make the moment last by pitching some tents and inviting the prophets to stay for dinner. Poor, poor Peter is usually the one identified as the fool, but seriously, why do we give James and John a pass in today's reading? Why don't we shake our heads at them like we do at Peter? Have we been listening? Are we paying attention? So you may have heard that there's $1 billion at stake in the Mega Millions jackpot on Tuesday night, and the Powerball didn't have a winner last night. Have you bought your tickets yet? After all, somebody has to win, right? Why shouldn't it be you? Why shouldn't it be me? What would you do if you actually won? I've been thinking about this a lot this week. I confess, my husband bought a few Mega Millions tickets last time before he left town. How could we not? Guess what? We won. We matched the yellow ball, and we won $2. Truth be told, I am kind of relieved, frankly. My feeble mind cannot even begin to imagine a billion anything, let alone $1 billion, even after taxes. But here's what I do know. So much money is just not good for any one person or organization. Think for a minute. We have been raised to understand that we are to return to God the first 10% of everything God has given us. So let's assume, as many do, that a winning lottery ticket somehow is indeed a gift from God. So 10% off the top goes back to God out of gratitude, right? God gets the first $100 million. Do me a big favor. If one of you wins this big jackpot, please, please do not tithe that back to this church in one lump sum. Really, just up your weekly or monthly offering significantly, but not extraordinarily. And here is why. I have been part of a church that received a huge, huge gift when a wealthy member died. The church did the right thing. They set up an endowment fund indicating that the principal was not to be touched. The problem was, the principal was so large, the investments were so strong, and at the time, interest rates were so high, these funds generated close to $200,000 a year. Can you imagine? So for the first years, everything went pretty well. The earnings were put towards fixing things that had been neglected for too long. The leaky roof, the tired church van, things like that. Of course, word got out about this church, and sure enough, attendance began to go up. But people weren't being educated. They weren't understanding the way these funds actually worked. So the thinking began to go like this. Well, this church doesn't need my measly $100 a month as badly as I do. My offering won't even be missed. Why should I even give anything when my roof is leaking too? Sure enough, before long, the giving had dropped so much that the earnings now were being funneled into the general budget to keep the lights on. In retrospect, it was clear that the well-meaning bequest was not really a gift, after all, but a life-sucking burden. Selfishness overtook the congregation. They forgot that it's less about the amount we give and more about the heart behind our giving. We give first to God because God first gave to us, gave it all, everything. Everything God has is ours for the asking. The problem that congregation had wasn't the generosity of one person. The problem that congregation had was that everyone else began to believe that their gifts and they did not matter. That God's grace was dispersed based on how much wealth and means one had. One's seat at the table, ultimately it seemed to them, depended on one's earthly status. Oh, but how difficult it will be for a wealthy man or woman to enter the kingdom of heaven. This week we begin our stewardship campaign, and over the next few weeks we ask that you begin thinking how you will support Strongsville United Church of Christ in ministry in 2019. Now don't worry, I'm not planning on preaching on money every week, so you can keep attending. But here's a fun factoid or three for you. Did you know that Jesus preached more about how to handle money and possessions than any other topic? It's true. In the four Gospels, one in every 10 verses, for a total of 288 verses, talks about money. The whole Bible offers 500 verses in prayer, fewer than 500 verses on faith, but over 2,000 verses about money. Let that sink in a minute. In other words, I'm in good company bringing this topic up that many of us would rather dismiss out of hand. And if you're curious, my source for these statistics is Howard L. Dayton Jr. in Leadership Magazine. But stewardship, as I am sure you know, is about more than giving money, although that is a big part of it. God has given each one of us so many distinctive gifts and talents. Take a moment and look around at this wonderful family of Christ. We have folks who are gifted to sing and gifted to ring, folks with great patience and wisdom to teach our children, folks who meet you at the door with a smile and welcome you in, folks who actually enjoy doing dishes for 100 people. All these gifts are equally vital in a healthy church family. And if you don't think you have any gift to offer, we need to talk. God did not leave anyone out. Everyone has something to offer the kingdom. Now, in a little while, we'll all wander over to Pilgrim Hall to enjoy one another's cooking and companionship. And, oh yes, there's cake. Thank you, Chad and Brittany. As you decide what you'll enjoy today, think about the hands that prepared those dishes. Think how a dish might taste if one very important ingredient were left out. Imagine spaghetti without the sauce, or mashed potatoes without butter, or apple pie without cinnamon and nutmeg to bring it all together. Everything is important. Every person has a place. Jesus invites us all to the feast. and God assigns the seats. But I'm thinking, if you're looking to sit closer to Jesus, you might want to look in the margins or maybe in the back of the room. If your heart is desiring more of Jesus, you have already found the better part. Forget the billion-dollar jackpot. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face. And the things of this earth will grow strangely dim in the light of God's glory and grace. Amen. Let's stand and sing together hymn number 589. Here I am, Lord, and I'm thinking we're going to maybe do the first and the last verses, Mike.
Thank you. No, I